Okay, so there's a reason they created instant ramen, and it wasn't to nourish poor college kids. It's because making ramen can be a very cumbersome task. In all actuality, you could make it in one day, but you'd have to start it very early and you'd be eating very late. It's a great weekend project, and I've divided it over 2 days to ease the process. It's not something you have to babysit. You'll have time to do other things while it cooks. Today, we're making pork belly tonkotsu ramen. Let's get going. The beginning of a good tonkotsu ramen broth begins with pork neck bones. You may or may not be able to find these in your local grocery store, but most butchers or Asian markets should carry them. You'll need to source most of the ingredients for the ramen from an Asian market anyways, so that's your best bet. Before we begin our broth, we'll need to clean the bones of impurities. The easiest way to do this is to first soak your bones in cold water for an hour. While our bones are soaking, we can begin prepping some of the garnishes. Bring a small saucepan to a boil and gently lower in some eggs. Boil for 7 minutes and transfer to a bowl of ice water. After 30 minutes, remove the eggs from the ice bath and place in the refrigerator. Next, start by trimming off the ends of some green onions, then cut the green part into 2 to 3 inch long pieces. Save the trimmed end pieces and white parts for the broth. Now stack the green onions as high as you're comfortable with and flatten out. Slice as thin as you possibly can. Just run the knife along your knuckles, keeping your fingertips and thumb out of the way. Then place all of the green onion pieces into a bowl of ice water and place the whole bowl in the refrigerator. After soaking the bones for 1 hour, drain and rinse them. Now add the bones to a large pot of boiling water. We want to blanch the bones for about 5 minutes and then drain and thoroughly rinse them. Be sure to get any of the loose debris or scum off the bones. This is a very important step to achieve a quality broth. Clean your pot out and then add the bones back. Add 3 large yellow onions diced up, your green onion pieces, 1 large knob of ginger split in half, no need to peel it, 2 heads of garlic split in half, and about 20 dried mushrooms. These can be found on your trip to the Asian market. A non-traditional but very tasty addition I like to add to give another layer of flavor is a smoked pork product. I really like pork jowl bacon, but a smoked ham hock will work just as well and are quite easy to find. Both are quite inexpensive and add a wonderful smoky depth of flavor. Cover with cold water and bring to a boil. We're going to keep this broth at a rolling boil for 8 to 12 hours. This will emulsify the fat into the broth. This is the antithesis of how you make a traditional French stock, but this is the only way to get that creamy texture that a tonkotsu ramen broth has. To limit the amount of evaporation, I like to loosely cover with a lid. Keep an eye on the broth, and once it evaporates by about half, refill with hot water back to the top of the pot. About halfway through making your broth, I like to start the pork belly. You'll need about a quarter to a third of a pound per serving. This here is a 2 pound piece. Coat the pork belly in a hoisin sauce and place in a baking dish. Add a large diced onion and 2 carrots with about 10 cloves of peeled garlic. Add a quarter cup of fish sauce and about a half cup of rice wine vinegar. Then cover with some of the simmering ramen broth. I like to cover with a piece of parchment paper before covering with foil. Bake in a 275 degree oven for 3 to 4 hours. The pork belly should be jiggly when touched, and you should be able to insert a paring knife with little to no resistance. Refrigerate the pork belly in the cooking liquid overnight. The pork belly will be much easier to work with when it's cold. After about 8 hours, this is what our broth should look like. You can go as long as 12. I had to refill the pot twice with water over the 8 hour cooking period. After the final time the broth evaporates by half, you can strain it through a fine mesh strainer and refrigerate. Alright, the next day we can start our ramen noodles. I've seen several videos and recipes for how to make ramen, and almost none of them make their own noodles. Even a lot of the ramen shops in Japan don't make their own noodles. This is because making ramen noodles can be very tricky, but with a few tips and tricks, hopefully you feel up to the challenge. But it doesn't hurt to grab some dried ramen noodles while you're at the Asian market in case something goes wrong. The key to success in a kitchen is to have a contingency plan. To make the noodles, start with 160 grams of lukewarm water, then add 8 grams of baking soda and 4 grams of kosher salt. Stir until completely dissolved. In the bowl of a stand mixer, add 396 grams of bread flour, and optionally 4 grams of vital wheat gluten. The vital wheat gluten gives the noodles their signature chewy texture. I'll add a link down below where you can order it. I haven't been able to find any locally where I live. These noodles can technically be made by hand if you don't have a stand mixer, but it will be quite difficult to mix. This dough is much drier than an Italian style pasta dough and does not lend itself to being handmade the same way. Turn the mixer to a medium speed with a dough hook attachment and add a third of the water mixture at a time. Be sure to let all the water absorb before you add each third. I like to scrape the sides of the bowl each time to make sure the water incorporates as evenly as possible. Once the water is all added, the mixture will not look at all like a dough, but more of a shaggy mass of flour with some large and small pieces. Press the flour mixture together with your hand and place in the center of a piece of plastic wrap. Form tightly into a ball and let the dough rest for 1 hour. After 1 hour, the mixture will start to take form, but the dough will still be very dry and lumpy. This dough is far too dry to knead like pasta, so we're gonna let the pasta roller do the kneading for us. Cut the mixture in half and flatten enough to put through the largest setting on a pasta roller. This will take a little effort, but it'll fit. This dough will not be pretty in the beginning, so just do whatever you have to do to get it through the machine. I promise it'll smooth out in the end. If at any point there are any holes or imperfections, fold the dough over itself and smash it together. Run it through the first setting twice, and then go down a setting each time you pass it through the machine, until you've gone through the first 5 settings. Then fold the dough in half long ways, and repeat the process starting with the widest setting again. Wrap the dough in plastic and let rest for 30 minutes. Do the same process for the second piece of dough, then 30 minutes later we're going to repeat the entire process we did the first time, running through the first 5 settings twice. Giving the dough this extra rest time allows it to relax and it becomes much easier to work with. Once both halves of the dough have been through the pasta roller for the final time, I like to square up the ends and cut into the desired length. In Japan, it is actually very socially acceptable to slurp your noodles and actually shows a sign of respect to the person who made them for you, so long noodles are ideal. You can use a linguine or spaghetti cutting attachment if you have it, or you can cut the noodles by hand. Lay the cut noodles on your work surface and lightly roll in flour. Grasp them with 2 fingers in the center of the strands and lay the end on the table and twirl them around and fold over the ends. This is called a nest and it makes the noodles easier to store and cook. Place them in an airtight container in the refrigerator for at least 1 hour, but up to 48 hours is okay. While our noodles are resting, we can finish the pork belly. Remove the layer of fat that has settled to the top and place the pork on a cutting board. Put the pan in the oven or pour the braising liquid in a pot to heat up. Cut the pork belly into 1/2-inch thick slices and be careful not to smash it. It will be very soft and tender even when it's cold. Place in a non-stick pan on a medium heat and caramelize the first side for 2 to 3 minutes. Just before turning the pork belly, baste the top side with a mixture of 2 tablespoons of hoisin and 1 teaspoon of fish sauce. Turn over and be careful, the fat in the pan will pop and sizzle when the hoisin mixture hits the pan. Cook for 1 to 2 minutes and place the pork on a wire rack or paper towel. After the braising liquid from the pork belly is warm, strain and reserve the whole garlic cloves for a garnish. We'll be using the braising liquid as a base for our dashi. A dashi is an extremely umami-rich broth that we're going to use to fortify our ramen. Traditionally, you start with plain water, but we're not going to let this braising liquid go to waste. We begin the dashi by adding kombu, which is dried Japanese sea kelp. If there's any dirt on the kombu, wipe it away with a dry paper towel, but do not rinse it off. The white powder on the outside is actually derived from the kombu and adds a tremendous amount of flavor. Add the kombu to your braising liquid and add an equal amount of water. Bring just to a simmer and remove the kombu from the liquid. If the kombu is left in too long, the dashi can become bitter. Now we can add 4 cups of bonito flakes, or katsuobushi, which is made from skipjack tuna that is dried, fermented, and then smoked. It adds a tremendous depth of flavor. Bring the dashi to a boil and turn the heat off. We want to steep the bonito flakes like tea for about 20 minutes. After 20 minutes, strain the mixture and our dashi is complete. Add the whole garlic cloves that we reserved from the pork belly and some bok choy leaves just to heat them up. Now we're ready to cook our noodles and assemble the ramen. Add your noodles to a pot of boiling water, No need to salt the water as the noodles contain plenty of salt. Stir to fluff the nests. Cook for about 2 minutes. The noodles should still be very al dente as they are going to continue cooking in the ramen broth. Add your dashi to a serving bowl and then the heated tonkotsu broth. The ratio of broths is a matter of preference, but I like equal parts. Play around and see what you prefer. Add your noodles to the broth, then top with your steeped bok choy leaves, some raw enoki mushrooms, some nori sheets. This is the same seaweed you wrap some types of sushi in. Your soft boiled eggs that you've peeled and cut in half, your garlic cloves, our green onions that have curled in the ice water, and finally, our melt in your mouth pork belly. Tonkotsu is just one of many styles of ramen out there, and I encourage you to make it at home and enjoy the time and effort it takes. If you'd like to see videos for other types of ramen, let me know in the comments down below. And as always, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date with future videos.